Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Blessed Sacrament. We are here gathered to celebrate the life of Francis Xavier Colaco. Please stand. The celebration starts at the church entrance in the same way that we have accepted Francis when he was baptized, so we too accept him once again for bidding him farewell and commending him to the hands of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Excuse me. In waters of baptism, Francis Xavier died with Christ, and rose with him to new life. May he now share with him eternal glory. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son, who died on the cross, was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Francis, who has gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever. Please be seated so that we will hear the word of God proclaimed to us.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are in peace. For if in the eyes of men indeed they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace he proved them, and as sacrificial offerings he took them to himself. Those who trust in him shall understand the truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love. Because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with the elect. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. reading from the letter, first letter of St. Paul to the Thessalonians. We do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, about those who have fallen asleep, so that you may not grieve like the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose, so too will God, through Jesus, bring with him those who have fallen asleep. Indeed, we tell you this on the word of the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will surely not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself, with the word of a command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God, will come down from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Thus, we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, console one another with these words. The word of the Lord. Love you, Timonash.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. When he saw the crowds, Jesus went up the mountain, and after he had sat down, his disciples came to him. He began to teach them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are they who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. Blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the clean of heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are they who are persecuted for the sake of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when they insult you, persecute you, and utter every kind of evil against you falsely because of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Dear Marie Henriette, dear Antoine, wife and son of Francis, dear daughter-in-law and grandchildren, dear siblings of Francis among us, Isabel, Servolo, Joseph, Rafael, and Manuel, and those who are assisting or attending this celebration through live streaming, who are in India, Margarita, Teresa, and Fatima, dear other family members, relatives and friends, dear parishioners, my deepest sympathies. The Good Shepherd has called your loved one, Francis, to his side. Even though we believe that in the words of the Book of Wisdom, he is now in the hand of God, his loss creates a void in our hearts. We miss him, and we have to face life without him. Nevertheless, we are grateful to have had him. We are gathered here celebrating this Eucharist to thank God for the gift of Francis, to ask God to forgive him his sins like any other person, and to open for him the gates of heaven. For your loved one, Francis believed and prayed very often that it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. This is the last phrase of the prayer for peace of St. Francis of Assisi that Francis was very fond of saying, as you told me when we were preparing for this funeral mass. It is this belief that Francis is now in God's hands that consoles us in moments of loss and grief and strengthens us to face the challenges of life. It seems to me that this prayer for peace by St. Francis summarizes not only your loved one's life, but also his faith. He understood well that this prayer of St. Francis of Assisi is based, if not summarizes, the Beatitudes that we heard about in today's Gospel. Success and blessedness for Jesus is not to be measured in material things, but in how much we try to reach out to others, to share with them their joy and sorrow, and always to trust in God. Praying the prayer for peace seems to have inspired your loved one, Francis, to practice Jesus' Beatitudes. Francis employed the gifts that God has given him for the good not only of his family, but also of others. His career took him to different parts of the world, and he shared his knowledge and expertise with others for promoting the common good and for creating a better world. He tried to bring light and hope where there was darkness and despair, as he used to pray. As you told me, dear Marie, Henriette, and Antoine, family was very dear and important to Francis. He maintained contacts with his extended family, and family and friends cherished him. He was proud of his Goan heritage, and especially that one of his ancestors was a disciple of Saint Francis Xavier, his namesake, who brought Christianity to India. In his own way, your loved one Francis tried to love without seeking to be loved in return. He sought to give and share his life rather than expecting to receive. Even when tragedy struck his family, he continued to place his trust in God and did not let hatred and injury control his life. Instead, he was determined to bring love, pardon, and hope. He decided to follow the Good Shepherd, even though he had to walk the valley of darkness. He believed that in trusting God, he would have the courage to bring goodness and kindness around him. We thank God for Francis' life, for his gifts and talents that he had shared with us, and for the fond memories we have of him. His obituary that you, friends Antoine and Marie Henriette, shared with me states that he was endlessly curious about the world and that he managed to visit all 7 continents. He is now in the best of all continents and worlds, for he is now with the Lord, resting in God's love and peace. As St. Paul tells us in the second reading, we who believe that Jesus died and rose, so too will God, through Jesus, bring with him those who have fallen asleep. Death is the gateway to heaven. Death is not destruction, as the first reading tells us. It is a transition from this earthly life to a heavenly spiritual one, being with God for all eternity. Even though we do not know how heaven looks like and where it is, for being with God is not a geographical or spatial place, we believe that Francis is now reunited with his beloved son, Alan, and with all deceased relatives and friends. Given his love for traveling and for meeting new people, I bet that Francis has already asked God's permission to discover heaven's landscape and its inhabitants. He is waiting for us to join him, encouraging us to follow the Good Shepherd, who truly leads us through life and death to eternal life. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. And let us now bring our prayers to the Lord. So invite those who are reading the petitions to come forward. My dear friends, let us join with one another in praying to God, not only for our departed brother Francis, but also for the Church, for peace in the world, and for ourselves.
For the Holy Catholic Church throughout the world, for Francis, our Pope, our bishops, and for all ministers of the gospel, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Francis, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of Francis, seek comfort and consolation, heal their pain, and dispel the darkness and doubt that come from grief. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are sick, suffering, housebound, elderly, or infirm, that they will be comforted by the healing touch of Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the poor, the homeless, and for those who are unemployed, that our care and concern for those in need may be a sign of God's love, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For peace in our communities, country, and the world, and that God may put an end to extremism, violence, and hatred, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the human family to learn to respect the planet and all creatures and care for them as signs of God's wondrous love, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the members of our family who have gone before us, including Manuel and Alda Colaco, Roger and Marie-Louise de Pellet, Antonio Colaco, Thierry de Pellet, Jamila Colaco, Rui de Figueiredo, Eli Alprin, Anicia Sals, and Alain Colaco, that they may gather in the eternal kingdom of peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions that we hold in the silence of our hearts, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated so that we'll bring the gifts and prepare the altar for the sacrifice of the Eucharist. Pray, my sisters and brothers, that my and your sacrifice be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name,
for our good and good of all his holy church.
Please stand. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Francis, we beseech your mercy that he, who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior, may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for through Christ our Lord. In him, the hope of blessed resurrection had dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, until
as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Wilton, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Francis, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he, who was united with your Son in a death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. Distributing Holy Communion, which is very special for us. For those of you who, for whatever reason, could not receive, please come forward for a blessing and cross your hands on your chest. That's a sign for a blessing. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body food for the journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our brother Francis may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated, and I invite Antoine for his remarks.
My mother and I want to thank you all for joining us today to honor my father's remarkable life. The outpouring of emotion and remembrance for him from across generations, time zones, and all corners of his history has touched us more than I can say. The efforts that people have made to attend today are humbling. We know many others wanted to be here, but were not able or are joining virtually. This love is a testament to the impact my father made on all those he met. As you can imagine, it's impossible to color a life in just a few moments. It's even harder to capture my father's legacy in the time I have to speak today. Perhaps I could just take a page from his book and take 20 minutes for my remarks when granted 5, or somehow incorporate multiple languages with translation included like he did at my wedding. Instead, don't worry, I'll stick to English and try to stick to the time allotted. As I was reflecting on what I want to share today, I thought about how we typically describe a life well lived. We detail achievement, accomplishments, perhaps a successful career. And without question, measuring along those lines, my father was impressive. In academia or at the World Bank, where one of his colleagues described him to me this week as a very, very good economist. But none of this is what truly defined him. He arrived in this country as an immigrant with almost nothing of monetary value. He had so little early on that he would describe subsisting only on hot dog buns during his long first cold Detroit winter after leaving the comforting heat of his Indian youth. It would be a long time until he had very much. But the essence of him was as strong then as it was a week and a half ago. His zeal for life, his curiosity about the world, his interest in people, his care for his friends, and his absolute dedication to family, his very, very large family. And his devotion to my mother, his partner in all things, marriage, adventure, travel, parenting, loss, grief, celebration, grandparenting, and all of the other precious elements that encapsulate true partnership. My father had a palpable joie de vivre. He was passionate about politics, as he was passionate about the cooking of a perfect shrimp curry. As alive tracking gorillas through the jungle of Uganda, as he was belting out Louis Armstrong's rendition of Hello Dolly. A few years ago, when we were in the Galapagos Islands to celebrate his 80th birthday, a band started playing music, and moved by the tune, he pulled my mother to dance, even though there was no dance floor and no one else was dancing. My father had advanced degrees in economics, but his real PhD was in chatting. He could chat about almost everything. Politics, music, books, or in particular, your personal life. His particular specialty was in your dating prospects and marriage timeline. Far from meaning to be intrusive, he simply wanted to see people settled and happy. He deeply cared about those around him. Relatedly, he was unafraid to ask all manner of unexpected questions. One time at dinner, after our server stopped to take our order, he took the opportunity to comment on what he considered a new style of jeans, the low rise, and asked her where she had gotten hers. Why did he do this? We don't know. We were too busy mortified to figure it out. But upon reflection, it was simply his way of knowing people, of knowing about the world. My father genuinely wanted to connect with people. And for this reason, he made an impression on everyone he met. Just this week, I've received messages from nurses who took care of him. I've received family members all around the world, friends of every facet and decade of his life, and even the person at the photo store. They all said the same thing. He spent the time to get to know them and was always so kind to them. He was kind and generous to everyone. His other qualities that made a large impression on me were his integrity and his tenacity. He was a fighter. He had a very strong moral compass that guided his actions. At work, in a large multinational organization that sometimes was very political, holding to his principles was not always popular, but it was profoundly important to him. He consistently stood up for what he thought was right and accepted the consequences for doing so. It set a clear example for us as we were growing up. But his tenacity was most evident in the last 20 years. In 2003, he was told he had 6 months to live due to acute leukemia. He ended up living almost 20 years past his original diagnosis. Of course, in this, his tenacity was matched by my mother's. That my father stayed healthy for so long and lived to meet his grandsons is a testament to my mother's dedication. He survived his illness and thrived in his later years thanks to her. I'm so grateful to you, Mom. It also helps to have 5 times the number of siblings that most people do when trying to match bone marrow. So I'm grateful to you too, Tifatu. He mischievously remarked that he became younger and better looking thanks to you, Tifatu. For my father, family and friends were his world. He truly cherished each and every one of you. Even though we didn't live close to our extended family, he always made sure we had opportunities to meet, whether in India, Houston, Toronto, or DC. It was important that my brother and I knew that we had the bond and warmth of family. I felt that not only this week, but all during the highs and lows of life and the periods in between. My father would go out of his way to do things for friends and family. Growing up, I remember the innumerable times he would act as our tour guide for people coming to Washington. He could have told them which metro to take and get to the mall and which museums to see, but instead he would insist on driving them himself. He did this no matter how long a week he had had at work or how tired he was. My father also insisted that people stay at our house or have dinner at our house. For him, it was not about the house, but opening our home, about being part of our family circle. I hear from my friends of 20, 30, or even 40 years that they felt at home visiting my parents. You too were asked those probing questions about your personal lives and perhaps given advice because he cared. You knew you were special to him. My father orbited around my brother and me. He was always there for us, setting a defining example of what it means to be a generous, kind, and loving father. Only after becoming a father myself do I have a sense of what losing my brother must have been for him. And yet, even in that most harrowing of times, he never stopped seeing my grief through his own. He would drive several hours each way to see me at college on the weekends to make sure I was all right. He was exhausted from work, was dealing with his own pain, but took the time to check on me, both to know that I was okay and to show me how loved I was. It has been a rare occasion since 1992 that I have not spoken daily to my father on the phone, and I've counted on him for support or advice all through that time. His voice alone brings me comfort. Over the last few years, we developed an unspoken agreement. He would call me during the day when I was working and leave me a voicemail. Even if I was not on a call, I would purposefully allow his call to go to voicemail. We would still speak later in the evening, in the day, but this way I could archive his voicemails for the day that when I would never be able to call him anymore. The content of the calls didn't matter. The steadying sound of his warmth, his joy, his unconditional love for me was what I recorded. Alain Zavy, I love you in just this way. And I learned to be your papa from the very best in the world. There was no greater joy from Avo than seeing you born and watching you grow up. There's possibly no greater amusement for us than the day we watched Avo try to figure out how to put a baby on a baby Bjorn and take you for a walk outside with his sunglasses. Know that he will always be watching over you. Pops, I know you're now with your son, Alain. I imagine the abrazo you will give him, the way you will laugh with him, and the joy you will feel. Your body is strong again, and I hope you're playing soccer together. Someday I hope to play with you both again. I will always hear your voice. Thank you.
Thank you, Antoine, for sharing the memories of your dad, and I will hope that these memories will continue to guide you in these moments of loss and grief, and also gives you the strength, through God's grace, to face the challenges of life. We have now a concluding ritual. In our tradition, it's called the rite of commendation, because the remains of Francis is the remains of a person, and we acknowledge that. And also we want to acknowledge the gift of life God has given to Francis. Please stand. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
More.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Francis in the sure and certain hope that, together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Francis in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest.